we are here to attend the public defense of Ahmed Zerouali's PhD thesis in science, more specifically in computer science. So let's start with the presentation of the jury. So the external members of the jury are Dr. Jesus Gonzalez Barahona, who is professor at the University Rey Juan Carlos de Madrid, Dr. Alexander Serebrenik, who is associate professor at the Eindhoven University of Technology in the Netherlands, and the local members of the jury are Dr. Alexandre Lecan, who is a postdoctoral researcher at the University of Mons in the Computer Science Department, and the advisor of the thesis, Dr. Tom Mens, who is professor at UMass, is at the head of the Software Engineering Laboratory. And myself, of course, Dr. Olivier Delfranche, associate professor in Computer Science Department of UMass. So Ahmed Zerouali, private defense successfully held on the 4th of July, and therefore we will now listen to the public presentation of the thesis entitled Measurement Framework for Analyzing Technical Lag in Open Source Software Ecosystems.
Thank you very much. Hello everyone, and welcome to the presentation of my public PhD defense, titled the Measurement Framework for Analyzing Technical Lag in Open Source Software Ecosystems. So before I start, I would like to thank the jury members for accepting to review my work and for accepting to be part of my jury members. And I also would like to mention that my PhD and my work is in line with the context of the SECO Assist project, which is a Beijing Excellence of Science research project. And it is funded by FMRS and FWO, and it includes four universities: the University of Mons, the University of Namur, and the University of Antwerp, and the University of Ubu from Brussels. And the goal, or the overall goal of this project, is in fact to provide more recommendation techniques in order to address software ecosystem issues. So as you know, software systems today are increasingly relying on reusable software libraries and packages that are distributed via online repositories and distributions like npm for JavaScript, Maven for Java, RubyGem for Ruby, or for specific operating systems like Debian and Ubuntu. So such huge repositories and distributions, they contain now thousands of libraries and millions of library versions. And in general, a software package is a piece of code or a program that provides some specific functionalities, and it exists in many versions. And we can consider that these versions are actually a successive states of enhancements of the package. And the package also sometimes requires some packages with it, or to be installed with it in order to work. And these packages actually, they are called dependencies, and this characteristic make software ecosystems even more complicated. So while this huge availability of data and libraries is good, and it facilitates software development and evolution, and it also helps developers to reuse functionalities that have been created by others, rather than creating or starting these functionalities from scratch, it can also cause problems, since such packages can become out of date. And thus, developers that will rely on these outdated packages, maybe they will be suffering from bugs or vulnerabilities that have been fixed in future releases or in recent releases. And so while facing or relying on these outdated packages is bit of harmful, it's not really an easy ask to update these outdated packages, since most of the cases, or in many cases, to update these packages we need some effort, and In some cases, actually, if we update to new releases, these new releases might come with incompatible backward changes, and this will make life even harder for us. So to study this problem of packages being out of date, we decided to focus on one research question, which is how can we help software developers to decide when and why they should update. So during this journey of answering this research question, we actually published some papers in different venues like Sainer and MSR for many software repositories. And in fact, we got for one of our papers the best paper award in Sainer 2019. And so the list of these papers are actually the core source of this presentation. And I think this is a good slide where I would like to thank the collaborators and the researchers with whom I worked, the researchers from the University of Mons or the researchers from the University of Juan Carlos and also from BTG. So starting with the technique lag, the technique lag metric was first introduced by Jesus Gonzalez Barahona, who is here with us today. And it is the increasing difference between deployed, it's the difference between deployed software packages and the ideal available upstream packages. And the ideal here can be interpreted in many ways. And each way can be meaningful. So if we care about stability, the ideal would be the most stable version of a software. And if we care about functionality, then the recent or the version with the most features would be the ideal version. And also the difference between two versions can be computed or interpreted in many ways, depending on what world. We can compute the difference in terms of features, or in terms of fixed bugs, or vulnerabilities, or even other metrics. But anyway, everything is in the eye of the beholder. So while assessing this problem of the technical lag is important at the level of individual packages, it becomes even more relevant and important at the level of ecosystems or large distributions where there is a lot of movement and where packages, they depend on each other directly or indirectly. And especially in the case of ecosystems where it is possible to impose conditions and constraints to version usage. For example, in the case of NPM, to specify which dependencies to use, developers need to specify some dependency constraints. And these dependency constraints actually refer to the ranges of versions that can be allowed to be installed with the dependency. If we take a concrete example of the YouTube player version 5.5.0 here, this package makes use of three dependencies: debug, cloud script, and system. And to specify which versions to use with these dependencies, the YouTube player package makes use of constraints. And in most of the cases, these constraints can lead to the use of outdated packages. So to give more context, in most of the ecosystems or package managers right now, the semantic or the versioning scheme follows the semantic versioning specifications. Which means that versions, they should follow a kind of a format. And this format is three numbers separated by a dot. So the left number is the major number, the middle number is the minor number, and the right number is the patch number. The major number can be incremented only if incompatible changes happen to the software, and the minor number can be incremented only if features are added to the software, and the patch number can be incremented only if patches and the bug fixes happen to the software. And any extra metadata or pre-releases labels can be actually extended to this form. So in most of the software ecosystems, they contain or they have their own dependency constraints. For example, in the case of NPM, the most important or the most popular ecosystems are actually the caret and the tilde. So the caret means that new versions or new releases that contain a patch release or a minor release can be installed, so as long as they are under the same major number. And the tilde means that only new patch releases that have bugs, bug fixes are allowed to be installed as long as they are under the same number, the same major and minor numbers. And of course, there are other constraints, such as the star, which means that any release is allowed to be installed. So if we take this example here, we consider that there is a dependent package P, there is a version of this dependent package P, the version is 4.0.0, and it relies on a required package D. And it, to specify the this dependency, this version makes use of dependency constraints. So in this case, this version will make use of the latest available version of the required package. So in this case, we will say that this version is making use of an updated dependency. However, if after some time the required package released some new versions. And the dependent package releases the new version, but without updating the dependency. Then, in this case, the dependency constraint will not allow to install one of the new versions. And in this case, we will say that the dependency that is used here is being updated. So, if we take a more concrete example of the YouTube player package version 5.5.0, so this package version makes use of .script, debug, and sister, three NPM packages, using these dependency constraints. And with debug, this dependency constraint allows the version 2.6.9 to be installed. While at the release date of the YouTube player package version, there were three higher versions, 3.0.0, 3.0.1, and 3.1.0, which means that at the release date of the YouTube player, the debug package version was actually missing some updates, and it was outdated. And in the same time, this version was making use of a package, MS, using the constraint 2.0.0. So this constraint allows the version 2.0.0 to be installed, and while at the release date of the YouTube player, there were two releases, two other higher releases, and so the MS also was actually under that package. So while this situation of packages being outdated is not necessarily a problem, it can sometimes come with issues in the sense that, let's consider that MS has some bugs or has some vulnerabilities that have been fixed in new releases. So in this case, these bugs and vulnerabilities will propagate to the debug and eventually to the YouTube player package. So to assess this problem and solve this problem of packages being updated or not updated, we opted for a mixed method approach of empirical software engineering. More specifically, we carried out qualitative analysis with interviews and surveys, including surveys and interviews with the developers to assess the usefulness of the technical lag. And then we created a formal framework for the technical lag. And then to show the applicability of the formal framework, we carried out quantitative analysis. And finally, to close the cycle, we implemented a tool that includes the technical lag framework. So starting with the qualitative analysis, and more specifically with the semi-structured interviews. So we carried out five interviews with five software practitioners during the event of OSDAM in Brussels. So all interviews were highly educated with an experience average of 10 years. So after explaining the technical lag and the notion of technical lag to them, we asked them about their opinion on the usefulness of the technical lag. And so we actually noticed that during the interviews, the developers stress the importance of the technical lag. However, they also said that a mix between the technical lag or the benefits of updating and the effort needed to that would be an even better metric. And so while these benefits here can be interpreted in many ways, and it's a variant that has many meanings, the idea also should be a variant. That's why we created an online survey that we published in Facebook groups. And the survey, the main goal of the survey was to know the opinion of developers about the ideal version of a software. And so, besides other questions, our main question was a multiple choice question where we asked what would be the most appropriate ideal version of a software library to use. So we received 17 answers from all highly educated interviewees that have an experience average of 3 years. And we found that the most important versions, or the most ideal versions for developers are actually the most stable with 14 answers and the latest available version with 9 answers. After that, we switched to the creation of a technical lab framework. So while the technical lab, as we said, supports one deployed package, actually it should not only support one deployed package, but it should support a set of deployed packages. Since in most of the cases, one deployed package will come with its dependencies, and thus we need a formal framework that supports this notion of a set of deployed packages. Moreover, the technical lag can be computed, the ideal and the technical lag can be computed in many ways. So the technical lag formal framework also should support this notion of variance. So indeed, we created a formal framework where we presented as a tuple of a set of component releases, a set of possible lag values, and the function ideal that returns the ideal version of another ideal version, and a function, the delta, which computes the difference between two software versions, and a function aggregation that aggregates the results of a set of lags. We also needed to define two more functions, so the tick lag and the aggregation lag. The tick lag computes the technical lag for one specific software version, and the aggregation lag computes the aggregation for a set of lags. And then, to show the applicability of the technical lag framework, we carried out quantitative analysis. More specifically, we considered two case studies in which we associated the technical lag while considering different standards. So the NPM packages and then Docker Hub images. Starting with NPM, so NPM is a package manager of JavaScript libraries, and it is the default package manager for JavaScript runtime Node.js. And it contains now more than 1 million package and more than 6 million package versions, and it is by far the largest registry on the internet. So to associate the technical lag for this case, we considered two scenarios: time-based scenario and version-based scenario. For the time-based, we consider that the ideal version for us is the highest available version of a software. And for the delta, or the difference between two versions, we consider that simply the difference is the number of days between the release dates. And for the aggregation function, we use the maximum. And for the version-based association, we also consider that the ideal version is the highest available version. And for the delta, we consider the number of missing updates between two versions as a technical lag. And then for the aggregation, we consider the sum function. In other words, if we have a dependent package that makes use of a version 1.1.0 of a required package, but the latest available version was 2.0.1, then we consider that the 2.0.1 is the ideal version of this required package. And then to compute the technical lag in terms of time, we simply do the subtraction of the number of between the release date of this version and the release date of this version. And to compute the version-based technical lag, and we call it a version lag, so we compute how many versions happened from this version to this version while specifying the version of the update, the type of the ideal, sorry. So, for example, from this version to this version, the middle number, which is the minor number, changed, which means that there is a minor update. And then from this version to this version, the major number changed, so we said it is a major update. And finally, just a patch update happened. And so we say that the version lag in this case is one major, one minor, and one patch. And now going back to our previous example, if you want to compute the technical lag for the outdated packages, then the technical lag or the time lag for the debug version 2.6.9 would be simply the difference between the release dates of 2.6.9 and 3.1.0, and it would be in this case 4 days. And similarly for the version lag, if you want to compute it, it will be the how many versions happened from this version to the latest available version. And it would be one major, one patch, and one minor again. And similarly for the MS package, so the time lag will be the difference between the release dates of these two versions. And it will, in this case, it will be 198 days. And eventually, if you want to compute the aggregated technical lag for the YouTube player version 5.5.0, then we simply aggregate the results of these two. And as we said, we use the maximum function, so the maximum between these two results is the 198 days. And so we say that this YouTube player version has 198 days of time lag. So using this technique, we actually analyze the whole registry of NPM. So for all direct dependencies of NPM, for both runtime and development dependencies, we computed their technical lag in terms of time lag, in terms of time and in terms of versions. And besides other findings, our main observation was that the technical lag of NPM packages or newly created NPM packages is increasing over time. And this increase actually is mainly induced by the dependency constraints that are used in these packages. In other words, in NPM, people, they do not update their dependency constraints. And this actually leads to the use of outdated dependencies. We also computed have seen in the previous example, there are actually direct dependencies and there are transitive dependencies. So in the second case, we computed the technical lag for the whole dependency tree of package versions in NPM. And so we found that the technical lag is accumulated from a level to another in the dependency tree, which means that higher technical lag is found deep down in the dependency tree of a package version. Also, so besides NPM packages, there are actually some other packages and applications that make use of NPM and NPM packages, but they are not distributed via the registry of NPM or via the package manager. So they are distributed via other repositories like GitHub and Bitbucket and other repositories. So these applications are actually also important, and they might suffer from the technical lag since they make use of NPM packages. So that's why we decided to analyze this kind of applications. And our main observation was that the technical lag for this kind of applications is higher than the technical lag that we found for NPM packages. And when we searched for the reason why, we found that it's mainly because constraints that are used with GitHub applications are more strict than the constraints that are used with NPM packages. So while this first analysis showed us that the technical lag and its analysis is relevant, we switched to the second case study, which is Docker images. So a Docker image or container or software container in general is a standalone, isolated and executable piece of software that includes all its dependencies. And such dependencies can be third-party libraries or system libraries, binaries. It can include also configuration files, etc. And Docker is one of the main tools of this technology of containerization. And Docker actually is one of the main tools and the most popular one. And Docker Hub is the largest repository where to save Docker container images. So in June 2015, a company, ClusterHQ, carried out a survey asking companies about the biggest barriers to putting containers in a production environment. So they found that the top answers were 60% of the companies said that security is number one barrier to putting containers in a production. After some time, in June 2016, Anchor, which is a company dedicated for Docker containers, carried out another survey where they asked users and deployers of Docker containers about their top concerns. And they found that deployers' top concerns are actually security. And they also found and noticed that these deployers focused on simple CVE scanning in order to monitor their images' security. And after that, in 2017, they carried out another survey where they asked deployers about the landscape practices of deploying Docker containers. And so, besides other questions, they asked, other than security, what are the other checks that you perform before running application containers? So the top answers that were related to software packages were required packages with 40% of the answers, and major third-party software bug presence with 33% of the answers, and third-party software version up to date with only 27% of the packages of the answers. So motivated by these surveys, actually we decided to analyze the packages that are installed in Docker containers. More specifically, we decided to study system and third-party packages. For the case of system packages, we focused on images that are based on Debian, and for third-party packages, we focused on images that are based on Node. So starting with the first case, which is Debian, so we pulled and ran 7,000 images, official and community images, from Docker Hub, and then we identified the packages that are installed on them, and then we tracked them back to the archive, to the archive of Debian, and we searched if they have any reported bugs or vulnerabilities. And later we instantiated the technical lag while considering three standards: freshness, and security, and stability. So depending on what you want, we can improve the technical lag. So for developers that care more about freshness, then they can consider the ideal version as the latest available version. And for developers that care more about security, then they can consider that the most secure version is the ideal version, and so on and so on. And so, after the association of the technical lag, and of course using three metrics, number of versions, number of vulnerabilities, and bugs, respectively, we computed the technical lag for all the packages that exist in Docker, the considered Docker images. And so we identified these packages and searched whether they have, whether they are outdated packages or not. And then we show the results here. We show the results while distinguishing between the type of the image, so official or community, and while distinguishing between the distribution of Debian of the image that we analyze, so it's GC, Stretch, or Bastard. GC is the old stable version of Debian, and Stretch is the current stable version of Debian, and Bastard is the testing version of Debian. And so our main observation was that the majority of the packages that are installed in Docker containers, in Docker Hub images, are actually up to date. However, most of the images contain at least one updated image. So for those packages that were outdated, we decided to compute their version lag and check how much updates they are missing compared to the latest available version. And so we found that outdated Debian packages in Docker containers induce a median version lag of one version. And we noticed that this version lag is actually more important for images that make use of GC and for images that make use of Bastard. And the reason behind this finding here is that because the images that make use of GC are actually older images, and they didn't have been updated in many years. While the other images that make use of Bastard, they cannot keep up with the updating process of Bastard, because Bastard is the testing version of Debian, and each day there are new versions of packages. So it's still not really stable. And after that, and before we compute the technical lag using other standards, we computed the number of vulnerabilities that each image has and the number of outdated packages that each image has. And then we checked if there is any correlation between these two numbers. And so we found that the number of vulnerabilities is positively correlated with the number of outdated packages in images. And we also noticed that the number of images is actually related to the version of the Debian that is used in images. So GC has more vulnerabilities than Stretch, and Stretch has more vulnerabilities than Bastard. And after that, we considered another standard, which is security. So we considered that the ideal version is the most secure version, which means that we considered the ideal version as the software version that has the minimum or the lowest number of vulnerabilities. And then we computed the technical lag between it and the deployed and the actual deployed packages. And we found that images that make use of older Debian releases have more important security logs. However, we looked at the way to improve this security log. So if we want to improve the security log, what should we do? And so we found that in most of the cases, in 75% of the cases of the packages, they didn't need to be updated or downgraded to have the most secure. They are already the most secure ones, but still having vulnerabilities. And only a small proportion of 2.5% of the packages needed to be downgraded in order to have the most secure version. And so if we go back to our previous survey, so if the deployers, the code deployers are really concerned about security, they should know that security is in relation with updating. And then this answer here, it should actually go a bit up. It should even go before the required packages. And after that, and motivated by the different studies that exist in the field of operating software engineering, the studies that are on vulnerabilities that exist for third-party packages, we decided to analyze one kind of third-party packages that exist in Docker Hub. And so since we were familiar with NPM, we decided to study the NPM packages. And so to do so, we based ourselves on only official images that exist in Docker Hub and that are based on Node, the image Node. And then we identified we pulled and ran the images, and then we identified the NPM packages that are installed on them, and then we computed their technical life and checked whether they have any vulnerabilities. And so our main findings were that all Node images might be missing many updates, including one major update, and all official Node-based images have vulnerable NPM packages, and they have an average of 60 security vulnerabilities per image. And we also found that older images are more likely to have more vulnerabilities. And if you can notice here, there is a relation between the first finding and the third finding, which both they contain old images, and both they contain outdated packages and vulnerabilities. So this actually corresponds to our previous finding that we found for Debian in the containers. And after that, and to close the cycle, we implemented the tool Compass. So motivated by the fact that most of the available analysis software that are dedicated for Docker right now are commercial tools, and they provide information about the installed packages and information about vulnerabilities, but they don't really provide information how updated these packages are, or how many updates they are missing compared to the latest available version, the most secure version, etc. So motivated by this, we decided to implement a Python utility, Compound, which is a tool to analyze packages in software containers. So the overall structure of Compound is to pull and run images, and then identify the packages that are installed on the image, and then drag the packages back to their archive or to their package managers, and then search whether they have any reported vulnerabilities or reported bugs, if there is any bug tracker or security tracker. And finally, show the results to the user. And so after the installation of Compound, there are two ways to make use of it. So there is the command line way and the API way. So if we use Compound from the command line, the output would be a summary of the image. And this summary will contain the number of outdated packages, the number of bugs, the number of vulnerabilities that exist in the image. Moreover, it will contain information about, or the proportion about the vulnerability types, the bug types, etc. But if someone is more interested in more details of the image, then they can make use of Compound from the API. And in this case, they will have more information about the packages that are installed, how many packages they are missing, and then when they first released, when they were first released, and where they were first released. So also information about the vulnerabilities, the CVE of the vulnerability, which package is suffering from this vulnerability, and then the urgency, the status of the vulnerabilities that the image is suffering from. And similarly, if there is any bug tracker, then we show information of the bugs that exist in the for the image. So to summarize, in this thesis we focused on the goal to assess developers' updating process. To do so, we carried out mixed methods approach of empirical software engineering. So we carried out quite a deep analysis where we asked developers about the instruments they look like. Then we created a formal framework, and then to show the applicability of this formal framework, we computed the technical lag associated for different case studies. And finally, we implemented the tool compound that includes the technical lab. And so for future work, actually we would like to do more analysis while including other instantiation of the technical lab. And this instantiation actually can have different, multi-dimensional associations. For instance, until now, when we compute, we always compute version lag or time lag. So we would like to do other analysis while considering many metrics in the same time, and this way we can leave the choice to the developer, because there are some developers, maybe they will not care about how many versions they are behind, but they will care if we tell them, look, you are missing 50 vulnerability fixes. So this actually is a future work for us. Also, there is always this trade-off effort and updating. So it's not really necessary sometimes to update. And as Dario before, so there was a presentation today where it was about updating libraries, etc. And one of their main findings was that the developers, they don't really care about updating. So they don't really care because their libraries, it simply works. So it simply works. So that's why we think that creation or association of technical lag while showing the effort needed to reduce it would be a good metric. I also would like to extend and enhance compound. So compound 4 right now supports only NPM packages and DBM packages. I would like to include at least RubyGem and Maven and Ubuntu. But also, I would really like to enhance it to other very popular ecosystems. I also would like to carry out more analysis on different ecosystems, and then do a cross comparison between these ecosystems. And this way, we can actually have an opinion about the common and the different practices that exist for each ecosystem. And finally, I would really like to promote the technical lab to be used by software developers. So use technical lab, please. And I would like to convince developers to make use of the technical lab, because I think it's an important metric. So to do so, I will try to talk to developers during venues and conferences, etc. I also will promote a bit of compound. And eventually, maybe include the technical lag metric in analysis tools like Greenwood Lab tool or other tools. And so, finally, as a conclusion statement, I would like to say that the technical lag and the actionable findings and the tools that were implemented in this thesis can be used to help open source software developers in to keep their software in a healthy shape. That's it. Thank you.
Professor Gonzalez, you could ask your question.
Thank you very much. So, I know the work was hard. Instead of asking about the details of the work, I'm going to ask about more general cases and stuff. So, being with You also analyzed several different ecosystems like MDI or Libya or. The question is, when you came to a new ecosystem, what kind of information do you need in it for being able of use the thing like concept in it? So what do you need?
Okay, so it depends on the ecosystem, of course. So in the case of Docker Hub, we couldn't find this this notion of constraints, so we always find the packages and styles in the Docker containers. But in the case of NPM, we needed to know first the constraints that are used in the package manager. So depending on the ecosystem, for instance, if you want to analyze the technical line for RubyGem, then we will for sure need to know which versioning scheme they use and which dependency constraint they use. I think this is the most important thing, and later we can go into more in
detail. Still talking about tools and optimization of the technical concept, you have this campaign too. How far do you think it is from being actually useful so that, for instance, when you are deploying containers automatically, you compute some like staff and take decisions based on that, like I'm not going to deploy because there is too much cynical lag in this specific image.
Okay, so the tool right now has been started by 38 people in GitHub. I don't know if they are really making use of the tool or not, but 39, thank you. So I'm not sure if they make use of the tool or not, but I'm pretty sure that what the tool provides actually don't exist in other tools. For instance, Anchor, it was an open source tool and I used Anchor many times. They don't really use this notion of the technical, like how much you are missing. So they consider, and they can tell you information about if you have outdated packages or not, but they consider a package that is one patch lagging as a package version that is three major versions lagging behind. So this actually is not fair, and I think the fund came to give this information to the Docker deployers. So I think if deployers are really interested in this matter, they can really benefit from it.
Okay, related to that, when you are mentioning technical lag, one of the problems that I always find with the concept is how to compute the differences between what I have and what I would like to get. My impression is that right now the kind of metrics that we are using are pretty simple, like number of bags. In which direction do you think this could be improved so that the information were more accurate or more useful for the practitioner?
So I think that the most important thing is to conclude the technical lag while considering the effort. So consider the technical lag. So if we say that there is a difference between two versions in terms of versions, that then we also report the effort needed to reduce this technical lag. I think for my future work on my very soon future work, because right now we are going to start working on this. I hope to check on some ecosystems, for instance, in the case of Maven. So I would like to go to check for the packages that had a package version and that had a technical lag and then reduced it. I would like to check what they did. And then do the same analysis for different packages, and finally try to give kind of a guidelines to people that have similar technical lag. So we say that I would like to have like some guidelines that say that so 70% of the packages that make use of this dependency, they actually needed to have 70 commits. So if you are going to update this dependency, maybe you will need the same amount of effort. So this is
okay. Related to that, one of the main takeaways that I find from your research is that when the developer is specifying the dependencies of the tool, one of the things that may happen is that can have technical lag even if all the direct dependencies are in the latest version, because technically hidden in dependencies way below the first level. that's something that the developer can know.
Exactly.
How do you think that could be, highlighted at the ecosystem level or something, so that developers in those hidden levels could care a bit more, trying to improve the dependencies so that the technical increases for the whole ecosystem? Because that can have a lot of impact in many, many applications. I mean, if they are in the lower levels of the dependency.
Okay, I agree. So, what I know is that in NPM, for instance, so there are some kind of packages that are kind of the core packages of NPM. So they are from Node and they are core packages. And when you go deep down in the dependency tree of package, NPM packages, you find eventually that one of these packages is making use of these core packages. So I'm not sure if these packages, they have many versions or not, but I think if at least these core packages, they cared more about their dependencies, or they cared more about their updating process. I mean, if they are updating frequently, then they are making life hard for developers that make use of them. So I think these core packages can actually help to reduce the technical update down the dependency tree.
And the final is more human than the question is, I think that you need, or that we all need, a way of pitching the technical thing to two different kinds of people. Yeah. To developers and to people deploying, or people caring for deploying. How would you do that? I mean, if you should be pitching to a developer or to a deployer in a couple of sentences, why training leg is important to them, how would you do that? Because my idea is you should start presentations with that.
Okay, yeah.
So that at the very beginning of the presentation, instead of talking about the concept in general or something like that, pitching it like, this is important for you because of this, or you're going to gain this, or whatever. How would you do that? And then so how would you do that?
For the employers, I think from the interviews, we could understand that the most important thing for the deployers is security. So I think if we are going to talk about the technical language, we should directly talk about security. I think and the rest is like what we said before. So explain the technical lag to them, but really highlight that the technical lag is a metric that can show you how much security you are lagging behind, how much security vulnerabilities you are having, and how much you can improve your system and the packages.
Okay, that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your talk, Ahmed. I really enjoyed it, and similar to my colleague, I would like to go more to the context of the work rather than to what technical details which I have discussed in your private events. So, in the survey that you discussed in the beginning, you referred to the trade-offs that developers need to make between the benefits of updating dependencies and the effort they need to spend on updating. And then essentially you started talking about technical lag. So I was kind of wondering whether you consider technical lag as a measure of effort.
Until now, no, we don't consider technical lag as a measure of effort, but it's kind of a proxy. Yeah, we can say that it's kind of a proxy to the effort. But until now, no, we don't consider it as an effort.
But should we, each community, consider that technical lag as a measure of effort?
Yeah, exactly. So technical lag, that's why I said in future work, I think the technical lag should support this notion of effort. And in the association, there should be the effort, but until now, we didn't really consider it as an effort.
Now, you know, there is an entire body of literature on effort estimation in software engineering. Think about models like Kokomo, think about function points. How would you position technical lag as a new effort measurement with respect to those things?
Okay, to be honest, I don't really have an idea about the effort techniques that were used, right? So, but for the technical lag right now, I mean, what we are doing right now, we are just measuring, right? But I think that if we try to compare what we are measuring to what other developers or to what other people are doing, I think This is definitely an effort. This is definitely a metric that is computing an effort because it's comparing it to what people are doing, and then from what people are doing, we can have an idea about how much time they needed to update or to reduce the ticking clock and things like this.
Mm-hmm. Okay. My second question would be related to projects which have high technical lag and low technical lag. Can you conjecture what would be the main difference? Why do some projects have high technical lag and some others which have a low one?
So why?
Yes.
Okay. So why? I think, so as that you said before, so I think it's always in the mind of the developer, right?
Yeah.
So there are some people that are careful and they want to be up to date and they care about this notion of not technical debt, but kind of technical debt. So they say, if I'm going to update each time, then maybe when I have a real problem, it would be easy for me to update that problem. But there are some others that they don't care at all, and that's why they have really big technical lag. So I think it's always depending on the developers. I think until now what we analyzed is the open source, the packages. So I'm really here to, I really want to know what technical lag we can find if we analyze industrial packages or industrial applications, because in that case, I don't know actually, I don't have any expectations, but I think maybe we will find a difference.
So, I really like the answer because you are suggesting that essentially the difference between those projects is not necessarily in what those projects do,
yeah,
but in a particular person who is in charge of the project, and in particular in attitude of this person towards risk in general. So, would you recommend packages to perform some kind of, well, not really personality assessment, but at least a risk attitude assessment before appointing a certain person as the dependency manager?
Yeah, it would be a good idea. I think, yeah. But I'm not sure, I'm not in a position to say that I would recommend people to do that, but I think it's a good idea, yeah. I think to study a team of developers and check which profile each person has and then assign the dependency tasks, I think it's a good idea, but I cannot say if I recommend this or not.
But wouldn't you expect more risk-averse person to be reluctant,
yeah,
to update because the most recent version can break?
Yeah,
even?
So exactly, yeah, I think...
So what would you expect?
I would expect that technical lag would be reduced. I think that technical lag would be reduced. If I have a team and I know that there are some people that are really careful about the dependency, so then I give them the task of updating the dependency, that for sure the technical lag of my project would be reduced.
So so we talked a little bit about people, let's talk a little bit about systems. Maybe we can show slide number 15. Yes. So here you see that Jesse scores much higher in terms of security vulnerability lag, both for the official and for the community package. But Jesse, of course, has been superseded by now. So would you use this kind of measurement as an indication when a certain release has to be deprecated? Or is it the other way around? Because it has been deprecated, the security vulnerability lag is so high.
I think we can use a technique like in both cases. I think for the people that are still using Jesse, they are actually following the thing that there is a, so it works when they change the image. So they are making use of GC because it works and because they have a stable image right now. So because GC is actually still supported by the security team and it is the whole stable. So just because of this, they make use of GC. But if we go back to Wizzy, which is the oldest one than GC, then of course we should report the technical lag and tell people, look, you have this high technical lag, and so you decide. Even if you update, you are still having a deprecated version, an old outdated version. So the best thing you do is to at least update to a stable version. Yeah, so I think that the usage of the technical lab would help developers here, would motivate them actually to update.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Alexander.
Thanks for the presentation. I know I already bothered you a lot during the private session with a lot of questions, so I'm trying to be the nice one this time. Actually, you already answered some of my questions. So what I would like to know is, you have a way to measure the technical lag. What can be done to lower this technical lag?
To lower it. To
yeah. You can update to new, more recent versions or more secure versions, but how can you help people do that? What kind of tools or guidelines can you provide them?
Okay. So, in the case of NPM, for instance, we found that the dependency constraints are actually the main reason behind the technical lab. So, I think our guideline would be to make use of some constraints that are a bit not a distinct, but more open. However, this is we cannot say to people simply use more or less strict constraints. But yeah, in the case of NPM, our guideline would be to change the or at least if you don't use a less strict constraint, at least update your constraints. When you update, when you release a new version, then update your constraint to be compatible with the new releases of your dependency. So I think this is the kind of guideline that we can say to people to reduce the technical lag. However, if we talk about how can we motivate people to use the technical lag. So how can we motivate the people to use the technical lag? It's actually kind of
not to use it, to take care of it.
Yeah, to take care of it, exactly. So I know, so it's the same. So if I'm going, can I give an example from the... So this is NPM, right? And it's a package manager of NPM. And when you look for a package in NPM, you can find some kind of metrics, some evaluation metrics. And the evaluation metrics here are popularity, quality, and maintenance. And actually, the original analyzer of or the original tool that provides this information is npms.io. And if we go to npms.io and check what they use to assess the quality of the package, then we can say that they are checking if packages are outdated or not. Just like that, packages are outdated or not. But they don't say how much outdated. So they are considering a package that is lagging behind one version as a package that is lagging behind 20 versions. So if we consider, if we put the technical lag in here, and the technical lag will have an impact on the overall score of the quality metric of NPM package, then people maybe will see that the quality of the it's really public. I mean, people are seeing that the quality of their package is reducing. So they will know that at least they should reduce the technical lag, and this way the score will go a bit higher, and users can maybe use the NPM package. And actually, similarly for the tool of David, you know David, right, to check. So similarly, if we go to requests, so the badges are really important, and actually, as I said before, that there is a study that shows that the badges are really important, and they let people maintain their projects and make them even popular. So if we go here and check, you can see that they are putting dependencies up to date or out of date. But they are not saying how much up to date. So if we take another package that maybe provides the same functionality as the request and has updated up to date dependencies or has updated dependencies, then the metric to compute the up-to-date will be the same for them. We are, because we are not saying how much updated they are. We are not giving the information about how much updated. And I think this is essential. If we put it here as a badge, I think it will motivate the developers to reduce the technical lag. If you put here, the technical lag that you have is four versions behind. And for the other one, the technical lag you have is one version behind. I think the developers of this tool will be motivated and they will try to reduce it just because they don't want their project, their package to be less quality than the other package.
So one way to prevent the technical lag to occur is to have software constraints.
Yeah.
What could be the trade-off between choosing between carrots and maybe some nuts upper bounded constraint? I mean, if you depend on some package and you do not specify upper bound on the version that can be used for that package, then obviously you won't have technical lag, and at least for the version based and time based technical lag.
Yeah.
What could be the main issues with this approach?
Yeah, so the main issues of this approach is first...
Because at some point it could break.
Yes.
That means you will have some pressure on you to keep your dependencies up to date.
Yes.
It's another way to keep
exactly. So that's why there is always this trade-off in the mind of the developers. I mean, if you put the star, it's not really as easy as it looks. If you put the star, then maybe the latest available version will contain an incompatible change or a leak change, and then our system will break. So I don't really recommend to use the star, but I think at least maybe know the dependency that I'm relying on. So if I'm going to rely on a dependency that has a lot of maintainers and they know that they do a lot of tests and checks and everything, then maybe I would be a bit confident to use a less strict constant. But if I'm relying on a package that is maintained by one developer or two developers. So in this case, I think I would be really careful and check which dependency exists.
And my last question is about the ways to prevent, to some extent, technical lag to occur. So we know there are dependency constraints. You can specify whichever version that could be installed. You have semantic versioning the specification, which can help you to specify the kind of updates, the compatible ones that you want to accept. Do you see any other ways to help the technical lag, to prevent technical lag to occur? Could be guidelines,
yes.
Tools.
So at the moment we have semantic versioning, the constraints. No, for now, it's not really thinking about something. But, yeah. I mean, for now, what we talked about is the one in mind, but I think there should be other ways. But I'm not really sure.
Thank you.
Thank you.
As for being asked about the use of the framework, so do you think responsible of ecosystem have to force their software developers to use the framework? Can we balance between benefits of the use of your framework and the overhead time in time using the framework? Do you think there is a real benefit or the responsibility has to force the developers to use it?
So I don't think that they need to force the developers, but I think at least give the metric. I mean, at least they should put the metric. So as I said, in the case of the NPM SIO or the case of the metrics that they say, look, this is the quality metric or the quality score that they have, but then they don't force them to make the quality score go higher, go to 100%. But they put it there, and I mean, when they put it there, people can know, and they will see, and they will understand that this package has low quality, has low maintainability, and has low popularity. Then, of course, I'm going to use another one that has better scores. So, if we include the technical value of this metric, I think it would be a good motivation for the developers.
So, it would be an habitude, feels.
Sorry?
It will be an automatic mechanism to use.
Yeah, can you?
So they're back.
I will not ask a lot of questions. Most of the questions have been asked already. And you responded basically pretty well. Just think I want to follow up on one of the questions that Alexander Dush asked. I have last two questions. So one is a follow-up on Alexander's question, where he actually, so he asked about this difference between packages that have a high lag and then others that might have a low lag, and so what about it? But actually, you could ask the same within the same package. I don't know if you observed, this phenomenon that within the same package you might have dependencies, some dependencies that have a high lag and other dependencies that have a low lag. Does this make sense? Did you observe this? And why would this be the case? Why would the developer within the same package decide, okay, this dependency can have a high lag and the other can have a low lag?
Okay, yeah, so of course we observed this, and actually even the example that I gave in technical level was 4.198. So we observed this case, and I think, from the interviews, when I asked one of the interviews, why would you update, he said that it has some dependencies that they should be up to date, and because they are the core dependencies for his project, and there are some dependencies that he doesn't really care about. So I think it also depends. Before I told Alex that it's in the mind of the developers, but I think it's also important. It's also related to the importance of the dependency. If you are relying on dependency that is really really the core of our package, then I think I will be taking care about updating it.
Another question, and this is the final one, I promise, how should I phrase it? So we have different, your framework allows different types or different versions of technical life. You can measure the distance or difference in time, in versions, in security, in bug. And let's say now, I use this combination of these different things, and I say, as long as my latest version or latest available release has no bugs and vulnerabilities, I decide to update. But something, I decide to update to the latest version because that it's the latest one, it doesn't have any bugs and vulnerabilities. But something that the for the measurements that you consider do not take into account is what I would call a hidden or unknown lag. It might be that the current latest version that, let's say today there is a new version of a package that you depend on that is released. Today it doesn't have any security vulnerabilities, it doesn't have any bugs, but it's really brand new, so it's likely maybe that tomorrow or within next week it will start having lots of reported bugs and vulnerabilities. And at the moment, your computer lag, they are still simply not known yet because they haven't discovered yet. So is it a wise decision to actually immediately update to the latest version of a new release? Or should you better wait until you're certain that it doesn't have any security or bugs? If this is what you value.
Okay, so I don't think that we should, I don't think that we should say or recommend people to update immediately. So actually, I didn't analyze analyze bugs and stuff, but I think there should be some guidelines about when bugs are actually occurred or reported in software systems. So we think it depends on the software system that we are using and the software ecosystem that we are using. So if we notice that, for example, in most of the cases, it takes about 3 months to report some bugs in the system that we use or the similar systems that we use, then I would say that, okay, we wait some time and then the technical lag, we update to reduce the technical lag. But this is not really a guideline, right? It's just kind of intuition, right? So the right thing to do, a guideline should be supported by scientific analysis.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So now the jury will return to the debate. So the jury has deliberated, and the jury has greatly appreciated your work. Ahmed Zerouali has faced an overcome important challenge in the domains of software repository mining and empirical software analysis. He contributed novel research results in these domains without discovering the technical intricacy and implementing an open source tool to support his empirical research. His doctoral thesis therefore significantly enhanced the state of the art in the aforementioned research domains. During both the private and public oral PhD defense, the jury has witnessed Mr. Zerouali's solid presentation skills, as well as his ability to present his research goal and achievement in a very clear and synthetic way. The jury also appreciated the candidate's capacity of responding with great maturity and relevance to the questions raised by the jury members. He answered the questions in a convincing way and gave proper credit to his collaborators. So now I have to switch to French because I have a link on the next to read. Vu le décret du 7 novembre 2013 définissant le paysage de l'enseignement supérieur et l'organisation académique des études, nous, président, secrétaire et membres du jury chargé de conférer le grade académique concerné, déclarons que Ahmed Zerouali a obtenu en année académique 2018-2019 le grade académique de docteur en sciences. L'intitulé de la thèse soutenue est « A measurement framework for analyzing technical lag in open source software ecosystem ». En foi de quoi, nous lui avons délivré le présent diplôme attestant que la prescription légale relative aux conditions d'accès au programme et au nombre de crédits y associés à la publicité des examens ont été observés.
So it was a pleasure having had you as a PhD student. In the beginning you were like a little bit difficult to handle because you were always listening. In the end, you were easier to handle, you were still not always listening, but
because you were speaking in Flemish.
You have made a really great progress since I still remember your very first presentation, and I remember your last even more vividly. And there's a huge world of difference between both. You really advanced a lot. And also the last year, I don't remember how many publications you have published, but it was quite impressive, also considering the total amount of time you spent on your PhD, which was pretty short, it was less than 4 years. So, congratulations. Before you, I don't know if you want to say something, before you say something, after, I have, this is a small present for you, but you can open it after. And after that, there is a reception for everyone.
Okay, thank you very much. Thanks for the gift. So first of all, I would like to thank Thomas. So to be honest, he's a really good advisor, and I really enjoyed being his PhD student. So I really thank him for his support and encouragement. And I also thank Alexander as dekan and Eleni for being there during these 3 years. Really helped me a lot. And Jesus, of course, Jesus and Gregorio, I thank them a lot. And I thank Vitesia, I mean, the guys from Vitesia, they are awesome people. So I thank them for hosting me during 1 year and a half. And of course, Alexander, thank you. I thank the jury members, Olivier, thank you very much. And of course, my friends, the ones that are here and the ones that are not here. And finally, I thank my family and thank you everyone for coming here today.